I spent a lot of years covering New Jersey politics from my home here in Hoboken. This town feeds one of my other passions, great food. I've always been fascinated by political deals and cooking great meals. So I figured, why not combine them?
Funding for Pasta and Politics with Nick Acacella provided by Gibbons PC, with 220 attorneys in New Jersey, New York, Pennsylvania, and Delaware. NJM Insurance Group, grown in the Garden State, and proudly serving New Jersey's businesses and citizens for more than 100 years. Fairview Insurance Agency, a family-owned and operated insurance agency with locations in Verona and Cherry Hill. PSEG, we make things work for you. Information at PSEG.com/saveenergy. Horizon Blue Cross Blue Shield of New Jersey, proudly serving New Jersey's families and businesses with health insurance services and products since 1932. The New Jersey Apartment Association, which represents all facets of the apartment industry in New Jersey. NJAA is home to New Jersey. And by CarePoint Health, with Bayonne Medical Center, Hoboken University Medical Center, and Christ Hospital, a fully integrated health system of physician practices and neighborhood health centers.
Here's your job. You're going to stir that and make sure it doesn't get all sticky.
The legislator who gets both the politics and the policy, Kevin O'Toole, has been a county chairman as well as a member of both the Assembly and the Senate. We'll talk about food.
My mother, Korean, she cooks Korean food, and she, oddly enough, cooks Italian food extraordinarily well.
Where'd she pick that up?
Watching TV.
And how the rough and tumble of New Jersey politics is not for the faint of heart.
When I put my suit on in the morning to go to Trenton, I say I am a gladiator going to fight. This is my job.
So let's get cooking.
Welcome to Pasta and Politics with Nick Acacella. Our guest today is State Senator Kevin O'Toole. Senator, thank you for coming.
Thanks for the invitation.
The senator has asked us to make a pesto sauce, which is simple but fragrant and beautiful. A couple of things I need to say about this. People think you can make substitutions in this. It's pine nuts. It's not walnuts. It's basil. It's not anything else that's green. It may be something else, and it may be delicious, but it is not authentic Genoese pesto. Now, pesto means to pound something.
Mm-hmm.
And originally, this was made in a mortar and pestle. We're not going to be that old school, but we're going to be old school with a 50-year-old blender. Let's tear up some of these basil leaves. Just grab some and just take the leaves off. And...
Oh, you want me to grab some?
Oh, yeah, sure. I want you to work.
I'm not that comfortable in these environments.
I take it you're not a cook.
No. I like food. I like watching it. I watch cooking shows.
Oh, all right.
But
okay,
I just don't do the act myself.
Does your wife?
She does. She's superb.
Okay. Senator, you got a... intriguing backstory.
My mother was born in North Korea with her family in 1951 when she lost two of her brothers in the Korean War.
Oh, that's a part of it.
Well, they were actually kidnapped, taken out of the house and tortured, never to be seen again. So my mother said at the age of 13, it's time to leave. So she
13?
13, yeah. She was 13. And she picked up the rest of the family and went from North Korea to South Korea. She went with her sisters, her brothers, and her father. Family got split up along the way because it was just a chaos, very chaotic. And the curious thing is, Nick, she wouldn't tell us this story till only like the last few years.
Oh, really?
She would not tell us what happened. She tells one story where she was coming with her father and the North Korean soldiers kidnapped her father and lined him up to be shot at a firing squad. And my mother and her sisters, 13, 14, and 15, threw themselves at the knees of the soldiers and said, "Don't shoot him, it's our father." And they don't know why. They relented, untied him, went on his way.
Wow.
Yeah, crazy story. So she lands in Seoul, Korea, in Incheon. She then works for the South Korean government, actually doing laundry. Then she's working for the military doing laundry. She meets my father, an American GI from Essex County, New Jersey, who's over there doing his service. She's washing clothes along a river, and she sees this American GI. Their eyes meet as they tell the story. They fell in love. He gets shipped back to the States, says, "I'll reenlist if I can go back to Korea."
Oh, he got shipped back and she was
Texas.
Still there.
And they said you couldn't do it because they didn't want to have the interracial marriage. They didn't want to have a North Korean bride come to America.
Right.
So it was all kinds
right.
of red tape. They finally got through it. They They married in 1957 and had seven kids and settled in Cedar Grove, New Jersey.
That's an absolutely astounding story.
Crazy story.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Was she a cook?
She's the most marvelous cook. As a matter of fact, 2 days ago, she made a whole thing of lasagna for my sister, her family. Yeah, she's an amazing cook.
She's Korean. Your father's Irish. She's cooking lasagna.
My father's a terrible cook. He's a terrible cook. He doesn't cook anything. He is a typical Irish, that generation, 82 years old. My mother, Korean. She cooks Korean food, and she, oddly enough, cooks Italian food extraordinarily well.
Where'd she pick that up?
Watching TV.
Really?
She taught herself to read, taught herself to cook, watch
TV. We should have had her here today.
Yeah, she would have been an asset.
Help us out. How did you get involved in politics?
I've always had an interest in politics. When I was 18 years old, I served on the zoning board, rent level and control board, goofy things, volunteer fireman, always wanted to be involved and didn't really have the family history of being involved. It got accelerated a little bit when I was a sophomore at Seton Hall University, took a class, American government. It was congressional internships that were a 3-credit class. They assigned me to a congressman, Joseph Minish, who was a congressman for 22 years in West Orange,
there's a
New
name.
Jersey.
Yeah, that's a blast from the past.
So that class, that congressional internship back in 84, really jump-started my love for politics. 1985, some of the Democrats in Essex said, hey, you want to get involved in an election? Introduced myself to John Kelly, fell in love with him instantly.
Most people did.
Yeah. And he won, and I became a legislative aide for a number of years.
So you went from being staff to being an elected official. You then ran for local office in Cedar Grove.
I ran for local office in Cedar Grove in 1989, my third year at law school. Was elected, became a mayor the next year at the age of 25, which was kind of like a cool thing.
Right, that is cool.
Served 7 years locally, 3 terms as a mayor, and then in 1995 had an opportunity to run for the assembly.
Pine nuts? Takes about 2 minutes for them to heat up. And the garlic, even with the skin on, we'll take the skin off later.
Am I expected to do anything?
No, I'll let you know when you need to do something. You frightened me. You said you're not very good at this.
So. I'm terrible.
You ran for the assembly when, the first time?
95.
What are the differences between what the assembly was like in 95 when you went there and today? Well, the legislature as a whole. How has it changed?
Oh, first of all, in the 90s, it was much more collegial. By far. When you have Joe Doria, who to me is the prince of the assembly, always has been, and he always set the tone in many respects. There was such an admiration that we, a mutual admiration that many of us had for some of the Democrats. Like, we always thought Karcher was a decent speaker. He had this gift about him. Doria was an absolute gentleman. When you said, let's sit around a table and, you know, make a deal that makes sense, he was the one. As it got in the 90s, it became so much more politicized. Mirroring, I think, the same time I think in D.C. it became so much more politicized.
How did it devolve?
I don't know. It became very vicious. And it became not only vicious, the Democrat versus Republican.
Internal.
It became very vicious, Republican and Republican, Democrat and Democrat. I think part of the problem is the fringe of both parties is incredibly, incredibly dangerous to our system. And if the left will never get enough, the right, it's always too much. And they will really be the death of both parties if we allow the fringe of both parties to take over.
But we do that with safe districts.
Which is a mistake.
The safer the district, the more likely the extremes are going to take over.
I think you should have as many competitive districts as possible.
I've been saying that for
Let
years.
Them go back and see their voters in a competitive manner. I've been in competitive districts. You know, I represent Union Township, Livingston, Springfield. Yeah. Been there. You've got to be really responsive. If you're sitting from your perch and you're getting 75% of the vote, and you don't have to answer anybody, it becomes easy.
I used to have a friend in Texas who claimed he never trusted anybody who got more than 55% of the vote. Because
smart friend.
Something wrong. Something wrong if you're getting more than 55%.
Yeah.
I'm going to take this garlic clove now. It's warmed up. I'm going to clip the ends off. The skin comes off much more easily when it's toasted.
I did not know that.
You're the only guy I know of who went from the Assembly to the Senate, back to the Assembly, and back to the Senate again.
Correct.
How did that happen?
I'm in the Assembly for 6 years. Towards the tail end of 2001, about April, the senator I was serving with, Lou Bassano, takes a job.
I remember him.
Vacancy gets created. County committee comes to me. I get elevated up. And after that time, there's a redistricting. And so then my Cedar Grove, my hometown, goes to District 40.
So you were only two years in that Senate seat, not elected.
A year. Not elected. Appointed.
But chosen by the county committee.
By the county committee.
Okay, so they redistricted. You're thrown into a district that's predominantly Bergen County.
Bergen, Passaic, Essex.
And Essex, yeah.
So he was, McNamara was a senior senator. He was also running for county executive, which was a sure shot, slam dunk for us the following year. I said, I'll step down, I'll support you for county executive, and then I'll go back to the Senate back in 2002 or three. That's what was supposed to happen.
That's what was supposed to happen. That's not what happened.
As Paul Harvey says, now the rest of the story.
Yeah, right.
So he loses, and then so he stayed there for a number of years, and at some point he said he's going to retire in 2007. And then I said, well, I've waited my time. I'm running. He and others supported a guy against me. They threw me off the line in Bergen County. So I ran as the non-incumbent without the line in Bergen, which was the exalted line in Bergen. And we happened to win. We did pretty good.
But Bergen was more than half the district.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So it demystified the magic of the line.
Yeah.
So you have your own line. It's as good as any other line. And you work your butt off. And we had a lot of workers.
We're going to give this about 10 minutes. Here's your job. You're going to stir that and make sure it doesn't get all sticky. Senator, why don't you take this and stuff it all in?
Yep.
Throw in a large pinch of salt, about a half a teaspoon of pepper, the garlic clove, pine nuts. There's a big debate whether to call them pinoli or pinoli. So I resolved it by calling them pine nuts, because you don't want to offend anybody.
Okay.
I've been around politicians a long time. Half a cup of olive oil. And a half a cup of Parmesan cheese. We're gonna squeeze half a lemon in there. We're gonna try not to get the pits in. My fingers catch the pits.
They say in the ancient Roman times, the gladiators used to pesto.
Mm-hmm. Except they didn't use basil. It was made with nuts and olive oil. Gotta keep moving this stuff around.
The first time in America they hear about pesto was 1944. The New York Times does an article.
That's absolutely true. Yeah. This was not something.
It was not a very common.
Not
or well-known.
Something that you would. That certainly nothing my parents knew. This belonged to my mother. I chose the medium path, not a mortar and pestle, but not a Cuisinart either. I think we're there.
All right.
You got involved with County Executive Jim Treffinger. It turned out to be not such a great experience for you. What happened there?
1993, we're mayors in Verona and Cedar Grove, and he comes to me, wants to run for county executive. So I said, okay, so I take a six-month leave of absence in 1994, run his campaign.
From your law practice?
Yeah. He won. We had an $800,000 budget, so I served as a chief of staff for a year. It was an interesting opportunity to get to know government a little bit, and then jumped out and, got into the assembly, and I left that position. But I learned a lot.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing like being involved in the administration of a large government, which Essex County is, for learning how things work. Different from running Cedar Grove.
Little old Cedar Grove,
yeah,
12,000,
right,
and you're
right.
Dealing with, yeah.
Right, what kind of budget?
$8 million at that time, and the county was $500 million.
Yeah, right, and a big difference.
Huge,
big difference.
Huge.
You're noted for being, how shall I put it, always at the center of the action. Whether, you know, politically or on the floor of the legislature. Well, reporters love it when you take the floor because you're a dynamic speaker. How do you see that role?
Without hyperbole, I will tell you, when I put my suit on in the morning to go to Trenton, I say I am a gladiator going to fight. This is my job. When I first came into the assembly, I was extremely insecure. I had a speech impediment.
This is something I find hard to believe.
Shy,
reserved.
And I used to write out my speeches in longhand, stand on the floor, and tried to pull myself out of that shyness. Yeah, and got there. And then somehow I just kind of developed a sense of calm.
That
as
is
I stood
not
on the floor.
Anything anybody in the press corps would ever associate you with.
Here's what I say, Nick. There are 120 legislators, right? It's the most gifted place to be. When I go down and I see the Golden Dome, I really get goosebumps. If you're not excited and jacked up when you're there, then get out because 1,000 people want to get behind you.
Yes,
but
that's
there
true.
Are, I'd say half of the legislators just mail it in. They just collect their check, they'll do their things, but there's a lot of us that really care about this stuff, and I get so excited and amped up. So while I'm on the floor, I'm excited. I got this blood, you know, running through me. The staffers are giving me great work. The OLS is doing great stuff. I mean, it's part of a process. I know what my wife tells me, I have one speed forward. I just can't stop that. So it is for better or worse. So I throw it all in.
And your partisanship tends not to be by party, it's by personality.
I will go one step further. The fights, I've had more primary fights that have been of significance than I have in a general election. After the election, it's over. You have to make peace and you have to work. I get along famously with a lot of these Democrats, people who want to get things done. Now, I get along in my own party. I got some really good folks on my side as well. But there's not enough of an exchange, Democrat, Republican, and back and forth. We've lost that art. It's lost. And I'm trying to, what I'm going to do post my retirement is trying to encourage, coach a lot of these senators to get back into that.
I'll do the heavy lifting and the spilling.
So you like cooking?
I like cooking for guests. I don't do the ordinary kind of cooking. I like applause. That's what we want.
Looks good.
Yeah. Very nice. Very nice. We've done good.
And you like pesto?
I do like pesto, yes. I like it on everything, not just pasta. You can put it on chicken. You can
put it on steak.
And steak?
Yep. Sure. Fish? Sure.
Eccola. There it is. Here we go.
Looks beautiful.
Senator, let's serve ourselves a little of this and see how it tastes.
Looks good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
For a guy who is so politically astute, you're also always in the middle of things with major issues. The pension payment thing. How does that get fixed?
First of all, this governor doesn't get enough credit. This legislature doesn't get enough credit. They're putting in more pension money now than the last five governors. That's not, you know, combined. If you're saying you have to put in $4, $5, $6 billion a year, where's that money going to come from? Seriously. So if you have some of the abuses that have been curbed, if you have some of these copays that get increased, if you have a look at retirees that may have to kick in, as Phil Murphy has suggested, maybe that's part of the solution. But if you're saying you have to put in $5 billion a year, that's going to be problematic.
Well, for the audience, how big is the budget?
$34 billion. It changes.
So you're
$36 billion.
$7 is going in. Yeah.
Okay. Absolutely.
Okay.
Nick, I believe in years past, and I hate feeling like the old guy here, but in the 80s and 90s, there were some long-term players that would talk about what would happen 10, 20, and 30 years. I don't see those forecasts and those models being used. Everything's about a calculus about what's the next election, which we get caught in that cyclone every year. And if you do that, you're never going to fix the problem.
But that's a real question. Isn't that part of our problem, that nobody's thinking with any kind of long-range vision? Why has this happened? Why are all of these lions that we knew in the legislature only a decade ago, why aren't they there anymore? Not those individuals. Why don't we get that kind of person anymore?
Part of it, I think you have to be a student of government, student of politics, to kind of work your way into the process. So when you look at the lines we talk about, these are folks who worked, you know, you start down as a staffer, you start as a political worker, you become like a council member, you become a mayor, you become an assemblyman, a freeholder, then a senator. You grow through that, you go through the farm team. But there used to be a growing period and you had some mentors on both sides, and you don't have that. Where are the leaders really in the Senate and the Assembly? There's a couple, but years ago it was more populated by people who had grown through the system that served as, you know, mentors for many.
Governors come and go. They last at most 8 years. And it was always up to the legislature to have the long-term view. And we're really not getting that.
They're all short-termers now. It could be end because they're worried about the next election. And that's really troubling.
What role does our safe districts play in this?
I think that the fewer safe districts, the better democracy you're going to have. Right. And it took me a while to get there. I think if everybody has to face their electorate every 2 or 4 years, they're going to be more rational, more reasonable, more center, more centric, as opposed to allowing, you know, if you're a safe district, you win by 75, you play the politics around the fringe, and you don't get challenged in the primary, general election's a slam dunk, there's no fear. And it's almost to the point which I've had to come around in my thinking, is that if they don't make it all safe districts, then they better start with term limits. I really believe that, because you're in a rubber room, you're not effective.
What about governor has come up with this fairness formula for school funding. What's his end game with that, do you think?
Listen, I've never pretended to speak for the governor. I just think he wants fairness. You have these, some of these suburban areas that the enrollment is growing, but the money's shrinking. You know, it's like 10% if you're lucky. And some of these in the formerly known as Abbott districts, up to $30,000 per student. It's insane. So if there's a decrease in the urban areas, they still get the same amount of money. Does that make sense? You know, if there's special needs and you don't have a, you know, a proportional increase for the proportionality of the
By the same token, you can't starve these urban districts.
Absolutely not.
The so-called fairness formula, some people say that would starve them. I mean, there's a balance has to be struck in here.
Here's somewhere. What I say to you. If the budget is $35 billion, if we doubled it to $70 billion, you're still going to have potholes. You're still going to have schools that aren't performing. But there has to be some sense of what you have. At some point, you have to say, what's the ability to pay?
Well, you know, with all of these problems lingering out there, you shocked the world, the political world in New Jersey, and abruptly told us you're not going to run again. What was that all about?
So literally 27 years of my, I'll be 52 this year. 27 years, more than one of...
More in than out.
Yeah. More than one of every 2 days I've been an elective office, councilman, mayor, assemblyman, senator, and 12 years as a county chair. It's a lot of time. So if some guy worked for General Electric for 30 years and they said, we're going to retire, would they say, wow, you're only 30 years? I've been at this for 30 years. I just started younger than most. I'm at the stage now, my son's a sophomore in college. My daughter's about to get into college. My wife and I love to play golf on the weekends. We're starting to travel. The law firm's doing some really good stuff. I want to just change the scene and do something different. You know, I'm still going to be practicing law. I want to teach. I want to serve on some boards, do some charity events. I don't want to go to Trenton twice a week and just feel like I'm wasting my time. And that's to the point where it's getting, Nick. Well, I'm driving down there where I still get excited about going on the floor and doing some good legislation and making some good judges. The paralysis and the stupidity that goes on there.
Now you have to leave.
Yeah.
I have to say
it
that.
It is what it is. There's people who go down there who speak from the heart, who talk and represent their districts, and it moves because people are watching them. It moves you.
I hope we can return to that.
I don't think so.
I don't either.
I don't think the farm team is there. I don't think the politics of today.
I think the way we pick candidates, a lot of these people, they don't rise. They are pulled up by outside leadership, by county chairman, by county parties, and they're not necessarily the best candidate.
Listen, if they gave political IQ tests, you think any of us would be in the Assembly and Senate? We wouldn't be the top of the class. I don't think we would. That's not the process. John Kelly told me years ago, he said, if you rely upon a job, a full-time job in politics, you'll become enslaved to the system. Because always have your private thing, have your family.
So would you be opposed to making the legislature full-time and paying them a full-time salary?
I don't think I'd be opposed to it. I think I would very much explore that. There's something to be said about that. But it really contradicts what I said earlier about being a slave to it. But, you know, we're making $49,000 a year.
Sure.
I can't tell you how many hours I put in a given week.
Absurd.
You know, when it's budget and judiciary and serving on committees.
But the public would say, well, we're going to pay them $125,000,
$130,000.
Pay your salary.
You're absolutely right.
But they're right.
You pay my salary.
On the other hand, you're going to get part-time quality when you're paying part-time salaries.
There's no doubt about it.
That's very, very hard to reconcile.
You can't do this forever. You got to get out and let the next generation come and serve. I really believe that as well. You groom the next generation, let them come and serve, and you move
on. But you're not abandoning politics.
No. Matter of fact, I say I'm a transition from being the player, gladiator every day, to being the coach. There's a number of senators that I'm working with, mentoring. Maybe it's a little bit immodest to me to say, but I want to serve as a coach to those folks. How do you become a better legislator or a better senator?
If you had one thing in your political career you'd go back and do over, what would it be?
I'll tell you what I would do. I'd probably vote for gay marriage. And I made a mistake by not voting for it. And as a committed Catholic, it was one of those hard decisions. And I had a conversation with my son at the time. I think he was 16 or 15, and I talked to him about it. We're sitting around a dinner table. My son said to me, well, Dad, why aren't you voting for it? And I said, well, it's a terrible conflict, and politically isn't that. He goes, but what's the answer? He goes, it's like a civil rights issue, isn't it? And he was 100% right.
What would you have been if you hadn't gone into politics? What would you have done with your life?
I would like to be a writer. I would like to, at one point, I wanted to be an actor or director.
Really?
Yep.
Really?
Yep. And when I was in college, I would dabble in that. So at some point, I may do it, write a book. I have a great interest in doing that. Talk to a couple of folks.
You go tell all the good stories?
No.
Write a book?
No.
Some you can't tell?
Some you can't tell. There's a couple of folks that I know that are Hollywood directors in particular that just, you know, we talk jokingly about writing a book about what's life really in politics, what's life really in, like, in New Jersey. So I've thought about it, so maybe that's part of
it. Maybe an oral history. We'll get you to tell all the good stories, but it'll be sealed for 50 years.
Yeah.
Everybody you mentioned.
The people I offend have to be dead first.
Have to be dead for at least 10 years.
That's fine.
Exactly.
I'm okay with that.
I want to thank you for being here. In my family, when there's food on the table and as much chatter as we've been doing here, somebody, usually one of the older members of the family, says, "Mangia stata zitta," which means shut up and eat. So let's shut up and eat. And thank you for coming.
Thank you for the invitation. Pleasure.
Funding for Pasta and Politics with Nick Acacella provided by Gibbons PC, with 220 attorneys in New Jersey, New York, Pennsylvania, and Delaware. NJM Insurance Group, grown in the Garden State and proudly serving New Jersey's businesses and citizens for more than 100 years. Fairview Insurance Agency, a family-owned and operated insurance agency with locations in Verona and Cherry Hill. PSEG, we make things work for you. Information at PSEG.com/saveenergy. Horizon Blue Cross Blue Shield of New Jersey, proudly serving New Jersey's families and businesses with health insurance services and products since 1932. The New Jersey Apartment Association, which represents all facets of the apartment industry in New Jersey. NJAA is home to New Jersey. And by CarePoint Health, with Bayonne Medical Center, Hoboken University Medical Center, and Christ Hospital, a fully integrated health system of physician practices and neighborhood health centers.